All right, hi everybody. So it's, in the last 10 years, another thing that's become sort of all the rage is organic hormone-free food. I'm gonna give you a version of that this morning. I call it organic PowerPoint-free keynote. So I don't know if it's gonna catch on, but it's just something this morning to be a little bit different, hopefully not hormone-free, but you know, something just to get you into the mood here today. And Warren mentioned that I'm a author, and I appreciate that. I have written 3 books, but as an author, I am a fan of other authors, and that is one of my heroes, Malcolm Gladwell. Has anybody ever read any Malcolm Gladwell? See, this is an audience that I figured that would have. So now here's your test. What was the first book that Malcolm Gladwell wrote that really propelled his career? Anybody? Blink was the second book. What was the other one? Tipping Point. Tipping Point was his first big book. And I just find that terribly ironic, don't you? That his entire career took off when he wrote about the tipping point. It's just fascinating to me. But what most people don't know about this first book is that it was talked about, the concept of the tipping point was not actually originated with Malcolm Gladwell. There was a man named Morton Grodzins who wrote about the tipping point. He literally did the research on the tipping point. He published on the tipping point. He named it the tipping point 40 years before Malcolm Gladwell's book. Malcolm Gladwell sold us all a 40-year-old unoriginal idea. Now, what's interesting about that is Malcolm Gladwell then made millions of dollars on the book The Tipping Point, and Grodzins toiled and died in academic obscurity. Gladwell can now charge $150,000 for a keynote like this, which is why you got me. And so what's interesting about it, I started to think, what lesson do we have here as messengers that Gladwell could take a 40-year-old unoriginal idea and make it fresh, emotionally connect with the buying public, and make it a million-dollar, multi-million-dollar industry when this guy, the originator, the first mover, nobody even knows him. In fact, I've told this story so often, sometimes when you Google his name, my frickin' picture shows up. That's how pathetic this guy is. What made the difference? I would argue that Gladwell told a better story. At the end of the day, Gladwell messaged the snot out of that thing. And he did it in a way that connected, made it applicable and accessible to the buying public, as opposed to Grodzins. And there's a lesson in here for us today. We can have the best product, we can have it first, we can be the only, and still blow it. But more than likely, you're in a market where you have something very similar. Sounds like, smells like, tastes like everybody else. But in either case, the better story is gonna win. So I wanna give you a storytelling framework, a simple framework this morning that you can take with you to construct messages that provoke the decision-making part of the brain, because that's where I spend my time in research with the University of Stanford, experts on persuasion and negotiations, running simulations and building frameworks. And I wanna give you a framework this morning. But before I go, I wanna just recognize that Gladwell's now written 5 books. His most recent book is David and Goliath. He's now ripping off God, the hubris of some people. So what I wanna share with you today is a framework for what I call the why change message. The why change message. Why the why change message? Here's what I see happening in the industry when you're trying to develop hand raisers and leads is there's somebody out there who's untroubled. And the goal is to move them along a process so that eventually they will buy something from you. But in greater and greater number, we start to see that in some industries that we work with, on the order of 60 to 80% of people that work their way through a potential buyer's journey end up making no decision. You probably know what it is for your industry, but this is the bane of everyone's existence. Gaining more revenue means maybe taking a little bit of share from the opponent or competitive rival, But the reality is the biggest opportunity to get share is to take a percentage of these people who thought, maybe I need to do something different, but by the end of engaging with you, decided they were okay. And look at that and understand, what is the science behind no decision? And scientists have coined the phrase status quo bias. What's going on here is something called status quo bias. And what I want to share with you today is the science behind status quo bias. And I know what you're thinking, man, it's early in Vegas, and I went into marketing to avoid science. But we're going to try and, you know, make it a little bit interesting here for you this morning and discover, and once you understand what goes behind why people stick with their status quo, you can do a better job of defeating it. Because it is my argument today that your arch-rival competitor is not your primary rival. It is inertia, it is gravity, it is status quo bias. And if you understand how to deal with that, you can improve the lead generation and conversion rates. So that's why I call this insights that incite. You don't just want to deliver insights to the market that make people excited. They like you, they friend you, they do all this, but then don't do anything. You want to create insights that actually incite a behavior change. So I'm going to give you a full-on model, then for what I call the why change story. Most people, as we look at their situation, are missing the why change story. You're great at the why us and not them story, but you're missing the why change story. So my promise to you today is you're going to have a simple four-part framework for telling a why change story that will break the status quo bias and increase the number of people who actually convert. And I've got science to talk about that and examples to give you. So the first thing we're going to do is discover the four causes of status quo bias. Once you understand the causes, you can address them. The problem is that too much messaging is guesswork. Too much messaging is instinct. Too much messaging is gut feel. And when we do that, we typically message in a way that makes us feel good about our products and our services, but has nothing to do with dislodging the status quo. So I want you to think of the status quo bias as I draw my gender-neutral person here, as sort of a ball and chain effect. And there's four causes that we're going to talk about that are keeping your prospects and customers anchored in status quo and not moving towards purchase intention. The first is called preference stability. The idea about preference stability and the science of decision making is that human beings, when they make a previous decision, establish preferences. And our natural tendency as human beings is to keep those stable. We hate uncertainty. And so what we try to do is whenever we hear something new, the first mechanism, the first defense mechanism that kicks in is what I call the liking principle. When somebody says, oh, you know, that's interesting, but I think it's kind of like what I'm already doing. I really think it's kind of like what everybody else is talking about. So when somebody says, I think it's like, that's not a good thing. Liking is not a good thing. Liking means they're trying to take what's new and stabilize their current preferences, resolve that back to certainty. So the word like is actually your enemy. You can't say something that the customer can easily say, that sounds a lot like, that looks a lot like, that feels a lot like. The word like is your enemy. I have four teenage daughters. The word like is my enemy. Like, Dad. So just think of it that way. So we're going to talk about a mechanism that's main job, and all you think about is you have to destabilize current preferences. And we're going to talk about how to do that today, agenda item number one. The second thing that causes people to stick with their status quo is they perceive the cost of any decision, the cost burden, to be on the change. Here's what I'm doing today, and effectively I see this as free. I made this decision to do it this way, and all the hard part around that decision making, all the cost to get started or restarted, all the first time, one time cost to get going, that's already sunk. Status quo is thought of as free. But that change thing over there, I'm gonna have to rethink my budget. I'm gonna have to now start thinking about the numbers and what I'm paying. I might have to get consensus between me, my spouse, or whoever else is part of the decision-making process. The whole thing has just gonna cost me a little bit of stomach lining that I can ill afford. there's this burden on change, that the perception that all cost is associated with the change and the status quo is free. So you have an uphill burden when you want to tell somebody they should do something new and they should do something different, that their perception is, that's going to cost me. That's going to cost me time, effort, and additional money, when what I'm doing today is already more or less just part of my daily operating process. I don't even have to think about it anymore. So your job is going to be to show them there's a cost of staying the same. What's the cost of staying the same? I'm going to give you an idea for that as you build your messages. Number three, status quo bias, is something called selection difficulty. This makes a lot of sense because we're not going to be surprised that we're overwhelming the world with information, and the defense mechanism is that you're all the same. And as a result, when you're all the same, this thing is pretty easy. I'm going to make a decision based on price. And if I can get a better price, then I might switch. Because the human brain, as we're going to learn, requires contrast to make a decision. And if everything looks the same, there's not enough contrast. So the only way I'm going to switch is if I can create some contrast. And the tool people use to create contrast then is price. It's the only lever left. Pricing is not a budget problem. Pricing is an effort to create some contrast. So then I have a reason to make a switch. And we're going to talk about the idea that you have to show clear contrast between what you offer and what they're doing so that there is a reason and the perception of value to make a switch. When everything seems the same, the only contrast shows up in price, and that's typically not companies' favorite move. So we're going to talk about how to show clear contrast. And then the fourth is a favorite of mine. Human beings are great. We can project into the future and look at making a decision to change and already start to blame ourselves. It's called anticipated regret. Okay, you know, so things aren't perfect here. The way I'm doing things today, not that great. But if I make a change and I do something different, that could cause problems. If you want to just sort of simplify it, what they're saying is, things aren't great here, but I'm not dead yet. Trying something new, that could kill me. Not literally, but the effort and the worry and the waste and the concern that they did it all for nothing. The anticipated regret is the fourth big cause. And what you have to show, and we'll talk about that as the fourth item, is a hero story. Often referred to as a before and after sort of proof point. And I will tell you that this framework has a deliberate order in it based on the brain science that I'm going to share with you. But you close it out when somebody gets, when they start to believe that maybe their current status quo is not as safe as they thought, not as scalable, not as tenable, not as acceptable. And then they start to realize that there's a cost of staying the same. It isn't just about the new cost. And then they start to see enough contrast between the current way and the future way. You still have to overcome their desire to avoid blame and regret. And so the proof point before and after isn't the first thing you share. It's one of the things I always see go wrong. The success story is first, but the reality is I'm not ready for a success story if I don't think I need to change. It's the success story is the actual cherry on the top that helps somebody take that last step and get over the anticipated regret and blame. So you with me so far? That was science, and that wasn't too painful, right? We good? We're still good? All right, great. Now, one of the things I want to share with you, take all the pictures you want. If you can't read my handwriting, I am going to have the LeedsCon people send out slides with all these illustrations, but much easier to read. But I just figure, what the heck? You only live once. Let's be organic and PowerPoint free. And also, I've discovered that people tend to pay attention when you draw because they don't know what's going to happen next, and you could crash and burn. It's like going to NASCAR. It's like, I don't know, there could be an accident. So this keeps you just a little more engaged. So let's talk about this, destabilizing their preferences. I want to give you one big idea, then share a simulation. Don't get frustrated. I don't know whose that is. I want to share one big idea with you to help you think about how your story, your message needs to open and how you can open hot. And it starts with something like this. So I'm going to create an XY axis. Because what, you're no scientist or consultant if you don't have an XY axis chart somewhere in your presentation. What I want to do is put the customer's needs on this side and your company's capabilities or your product and services capabilities down here. When you go out and do voice of the customer research, the reason you do voice of the customer research is so that you can identify customer needs and be able to talk to them in a customer-centric way about what they need, and then ideally link that to something you have as a capability, and that becomes your solution story or value prop. Because too often companies lead with their products and services, and now we've all been disciplined to do voice of the customer research and frame the story as a need a customer has matched to a capability we have. And if you continue in your voice of the customer research, you get really super excited when you identify customer needs that you're like, oh man, we have got something for that. This picture gets companies super excited that they have got a story that's going to differentiate. The only problem is, I have to tell you, that this story does the exact opposite. It commoditizes you. This is a commodity story. Even though you think you did everything as right as you could, what's happening? Voice of the customer research is pinging some of the same customers in the same market between you and your competitors. And what are your customers telling them? You're telling them that these are the needs they have. So you've uncovered these needs, but if your competitors aren't doing voice of the customer research, you don't have to worry about them. They won't be in business very long, but most of them are. So what's remarkable then is you're identifying some of the same business needs. How do I know? We take the logos off of everybody's websites and no one can tell the difference. You're identifying the same needs because voice of the customer research is a commoditized moment. Then what happens is you get double commoditized because you go and link that to something you do, but all too often your portfolio's products and services aren't that dissimilar from your competitors, so the thing you say you can do to solve that problem, lo and behold, unwittingly makes you a commodity because you're talking about the same exact things. And you fall right into status quo bias, selection difficulty, preference, stability. People go, that's a lot like. Then people's natural defenses kick in. This is what I see happen at companies. So I work with about 150 companies a year, and I get to see like 150 of their messages, their presentations, their campaigns. And what I see them going to is this go-to move. Hey, we've got things out here that our customers don't know about, don't appreciate, and haven't made it into this story. So what we need to do to differentiate is introduce these things, and we will call them, famously, value-added services. None of you do that. It's just the other companies, I'm sure, who start whipping in value-added services and say, this is going to differentiate us. Now, the interesting thing about value-add is that you think you're adding value, but the customer's perception of this in the science, the decision-making science of behavioral economics, is something called choice overload. Their reaction isn't that you just added value. They perceive that you just added cost, and you just added complexity. Value-added services, when we run the simulations and look at the responses, it turns out people's perception isn't value-add, it's cost-add and complexity-add. And we see stories and campaigns and messages that use that approach performing worse than stories that just identify the customer needs and talk about similar capabilities. You literally perform worse when you talk about customer needs, offer similar capabilities, and pile on value-added services. So somewhere in our gut, or somebody told us that's a better way to do it, but there's literally no science to validate that. In fact, there's science the other way. So then the question is, now what? Now what do you do to be different? Now what do you do to move people? Because herein lies the lack of urgency and a lack of uniqueness. And that's the enemy when it comes to preference stability. You need to destabilize their preferences. That in fact, the most powerful tool you have is the power hidden in what we call the unconsidered need. That in reality, you have got to tell the customer something they don't already know about a problem or missed opportunity they didn't even know they had. That's how you destabilize preferences and avoid the liking. Oh, that's a lot like, that's a lot like. By telling them something they didn't already know, which introduces a risk that they had not predicted, had not identified, had not foreseen, and now you create a sense of urgency, right? Because here, these are problems I have, yes, those are problems, but I'm not dead yet. I know them, I can identify them, and everybody's talking about them. But the thing that could kill me is the thing I don't know, the opportunity I might miss, or the thing I've been hiding and covering up with workarounds and other things that just made the problem underlying disappear, but it won't be gone for long. It's festering, fomenting, and ready to surprise me. And then the key, though, is that you resolve that risk. If you just introduce interesting, unconsidered needs that cause people to get uptight and kick their, you know, that hormonal cocktail off in their brain, but you can't actually do anything about it, yes, you will have gained their attention, but you are just a jerk. At some point, the brain science says, if I'm here on status quo bias, I am likely to move when my status quo is threatened or considered unsafe. I now see a risk I didn't expect, I didn't know, now it's unsafe. The brain then says, we will move if we can find a new safe. With no new safe in sight, the last safe place I remember is where I am, so I simply duck, retrench, and hope this too shall pass. So the idea is you must resolve that risk in your story with something that you do a unique and an advantaged way, and now you can talk about this thing right here. Instead of leading with it, you lead to it. And so what I'm going to offer at the end of my presentation is a link to detail about where and how to find unconsidered needs. Often it's a need that the customer underappreciates. They don't believe they don't fully understand the size or the speed of the problem, the size and the magnitude of it, and the speed with which it's coming at them as to whether they need to worry about it today. Another one is the one where they've done workarounds, and they've basically hidden the real underlying problem, and eventually it's going to catch up with them. And the third unconsidered need is generally the one they just didn't know because they didn't even know there was something to fix it. That's the one that Apple tends to lean heavily into. But there's different kinds of unconsidered needs, but the key is that the customer didn't tell you about them. You surprised them. And by surprising them, you can have a dramatic impact on their perceptions and their decision making. For example, we recently ran a simulation on this where we put people in a position who are looking for a line of credit from a bank in a position to hear pitches from multiple banks. And we were able to drive this kind of impact by putting a presentation in front of them that had introduced an unconsidered need that they hadn't expressed and compared it to a presentation that just responded to the stated needs. So we put that 400 people into the simulation and we told them what their needs were because we needed them to come up to speed quickly. And we said, you are running a small business operation, family-owned business, you need a line of credit because sales have slowed down, costs are going up, and payments are getting sluggish, so you need a line of credit. And one bank came in and simply responded to those stated needs and credentialed themselves and talked about their solution. But another one came in and opened with the idea that said, before you take any line of credit, you need to know that 42% of small businesses that take a line of credit during a recession still fail. That's almost 1 in 2. So what we want to talk about today is how you don't become a statistic. Think about that for a second. The bank actually started out by saying you could fail if you take our money. It sounds like a recipe for disaster in a presentation, but what we were able to show is a 50% increase in the perception of uniqueness, and differentiation. People said that is a unique offering. The bottom line is it was both money. The offering was money. But somebody talked about something they didn't expect, and now they perceive that partner, potentially, that partner to be supremely different. We were able to generate a 10% increase in the perception of quality, the quality of the institution itself, just by telling them something they didn't know, instead of just confirming what they told us. And we were able to show a 10% increase in actual persuasion, 10 plus percentage points, a statistically significant improvement in the persuasive power of your message if you open with, you lead with, something they didn't already know about a problem or opportunity they didn't know they had and did not express to you in your voice of the customer research or in the case of sales, your diagnostic discovery. So the first tool I want to give you today is to destabilize their preferences by introducing an unconsidered need, something outside of voice of the customer research, outside of that red box, so that you can create a sense of urgency beyond the problems they already know. And you can lead to something unique about you besides the capabilities everybody's talking about. Opportunity number one, and the beginning of your story, introduce the unconsidered need. The second part of status quo bias, after preference stability, destabilizing it with an unconsidered need, is this cost of change, the burden of the cost of change. And the science that I got to share with you here is a principle of behavioral economics that won a Nobel Prize in rational economics for a man named Daniel Kahneman. Has anybody ever heard of Daniel Kahneman? Thinking Fast and Thinking Slow was his famous book. His book is this thick, so I argue it's Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow, and Reading Even Slower. But it is, I'm gonna give you literally the Cliff Notes version right here of all of that science. It boils down to something he calls prospect theory. And the issue in prospect theory that's so fascinating for those of us who are trying to destabilize the status quo and cause people to leave their status quo is that people, this is affectionately and effectively called the Kahneman curve, people are 2 to 3 times more likely to move and do something different, to make a decision to change in order to avoid loss, as opposed to go after some sort of gain. He called it loss aversion. Why is this so important? When you think about your story, and you think about this idea of all the costs and all the pressure being on the change, it's because many of our stories lead with and lean into what happens to be the smallest impact part of the story, which is the gain and upside of making a change. Because the burden and cost is on the change, and their perception is that doesn't mean much to them, you have a hard time of getting people to move off of status quo, when in reality they're 2 to 3 times more likely to leave status quo in order to avoid loss. This is the picture I want you to have. If I'm on my status quo bias here, and that's the change you want me to make over there, I am 2 to 3 times more likely to go after that change to avoid some sort of loss associated with my current state, as opposed to giving me some sort of upside in the future state. Yet many of us lead with the gain and the upside and wonder why people aren't making that move. The psychology of it says is, yeah, that might happen, but not necessarily. Your results may vary. And so people kick into risk aversion. This work right here, Kahneman calls risk seeking. The idea in risk seeking is you want to know, when are people going to not be risk averse? When will they like actually seek after risk? They will seek risk in order to avoid loss 2 to 3 times faster and more readily than to go get a gain. And we did an experiment in a simulation here that I want to share with you and then talk about how you tell the story. So, if you think about who the least emotional decision makers in the world might be, or the people who profess to be the least emotional decision makers, who might those people be? Typically what we encounter are like executives, people who are like high VP or level higher sort of people. People that have arrived to a certain station in life, and they believe they've arrived there because they are rational, logical, critical thinkers. And they believe they're more like the Tin Man from The Wizard of Oz. They can't be affected by emotions because they have no heart. And so what we wanted to do is find out if that was true. And if we could move executive decision makers and buyers in a way they didn't expect, that might prove loss aversion to be true, not just in the average human being, but those who consider themselves above average. So here's the simulation. We recruited, in this case, 120 VP or level higher people who were in different companies, in different geographies, but we were going after the executive buyer, the ones who say, you can't sell this to me until I see an ROI, or a TCO, or a TBD, or an FYI. I have no idea what those are, but that's what they tell me they need to make a decision, because they're rational and logical. So here's the test we put them through. For half of the audience, we told them this was the situation. We told them they were working for an automobile manufacturer and they were encountering a recession. And the plan on the table from your CFO, the status quo plan that you're going to have to do, is you have a plan that will save one out of three of your plants, which means you will save 2,000 out of the 6,000 workers. But we told the executives that down the hall, there's a vendor who has a really cool idea that's potentially going to help us. And here's what that vendor has to say. They have a 33% chance of saving everything, all the plants and all the workers. But like in most solutions, in many solutions, whoops, don't need a box there. There's a 66% chance that they will save nothing. Your results may vary. So it's a very risky proposition. Risk-seeking, not risk-seeking. Are they willing to take the risk? Then we got another group of executives and put them through this, where we said, you're going to lose two out of three plants under the current plan from the CFO, which means you're going to lose 4,000 of the 6,000 workers. But there's a vendor out there who's got a small probability, but you're still saying, I have a chance. There's a 33% chance that we're going to lose nothing. We're going to be able to keep it all. But there's a high probability, sadly, that we would lose everything. Now, I know if you weren't interested in science and you went into marketing, you probably didn't like math either. But I'm just going to assume for a moment that you can figure what's going on here. The math is exactly the same. It's the exact same math. And we took two groups and split them in half so they didn't know which condition they were in. They all heard the same situation and then heard a pitch and some evidence around this choice. The other half heard it around this choice. If they are rational and logical, what should be the result? Exact same. Here's the results that we got. 74% chose, in this condition, chose to go with the plan that was already on the table, the status quo plan of the CFO. Only 26% were willing to take a risk. So when we asked the other group, senior executives with the same math, this happened. 55% chose the status quo, 45% were willing to take the risk. We literally generated a 70%+ increase in persuadability. I don't know if that's a word, but I'm going to use it now. We were able to take executives who claim to be rational and logical and empirically based in their decision making, and just by reframing their current choice as a loss, they were now willing to seek the risk. But the risk-seeking proposition was the same in both cases, and the current situation was the same in both cases, just portrayed differently. Your words and story matter. That seems like a subtle tweak, but for a 70% increase in persuadability, it's time we all pay attention to how we frame up the current situation of our decision maker, buyer, person on the other end, and help them realize why they might want to take this risk sooner than later. It just uses brain science to your advantage. It doesn't lie about anything. It just simply repositions it in a way that affects the person differently. I offer that to you today as step number two. Remember, the cost of change is the burden. Here, now using loss aversion and risk seeking, you show them the cost of staying the same. Until they understand there's a cost of staying the same that is equal to or greater than the cost of change, they're going to be stuck in status quo bias because the burden of cost is seen on the change. Step number two in your message. First step, unconsidered need. Didn't see that coming. Second one, here's the flaw in your current approach and objective and what the loss associated with that might be. What did I tell you? The third piece of this was selection difficulty. People have a hard time because they think everything is more or less the same. And here's why that happens. In many presentations or many messages and campaigns that I see the hero of the story being what I'll call the future state, but most people call it their new and improved. The assumption is I'm going to generate more interest because we have a new and improved capability or service. And because the customer doesn't have that, they're going to want it. There's a faulty premise there. I call it the Mighty Mouse syndrome. You assume they view themselves as a damsel tied to a train track, and you assume that your new and improved is going to save the day. So your messages sort of sound like this. They make you feel good as a company, but the customer isn't just hearing it. Because you come walking in and your story sounds a little bit like this to your prospect and customer. Here I come to save the day. That was free for you this morning. You can't get that with Wayne Newton. Just kidding. He's awesome. But the idea is the customer's like, oh, my sense of urgency is now driven by the fact that you have something new that you think I don't have. And therefore, the reason I should do something is your perception is that the way I'm doing things is wrong because you got something new, or the premise or the receptivity of the message is that I need to do something because I'm not smart enough, I didn't do it right, I didn't pick something right. The key of the story is you make them feel smarter, not feel stupid. Make people feel smarter because they heard your message, not feel stupid. And they feel stupid if you put them in a position of seeing like they need to be rescued. What you need to do is invoke the most powerful form of persuasion known to humankind, and that is self-persuasion. You have to identify for them a typical current state situation. What happens is we often think that the customer or prospect knows exactly what their current situation is, that they understand the product or service that they own. But they don't think of it as a product or service. They just think of it now as their way of life. And really, again, you're up against inertia, not necessarily a competitor. And when you start to talk about new features and benefits, you're hoping they can infer the difference. The reality is you have to help me center myself on what it is I'm doing today before I can appreciate whether or not what you're offering is different enough for me to make the change. Because that's hard, and I don't want to make a change for something that's essentially the same. Selection difficulty. And to overcome that, the key is you need to literally describe the concerns, questions, limitations, and potential flaws in the current approach before you start talking about any kind of capability or improvement or something new in the new approach. So that you, it's called the anchoring effect, that you would anchor them in their current state so that by looking at what you're going to offer, they could self-persuade how much different or better that is. In other words, the power here in this discussion is that the perception of value lies in contrast. If there's no contrast, there's no perception of value. There's only perception of risk. And so in your messages, you have to do a good job of identifying what people most like them are probably doing today and what the challenges and concerns are and the risks, so that they can see why you did what you did and how that resolves those risks and challenges. So the story, I call it telling a story with contrast, allows me to now begin to self-identify with, you know, that does sound a lot like what I'm doing. It helps me appreciate now more why this is important. Value perception lies in contrast. No contrast, no value. This is why this happens. I got to give you now one lesson in brain science. There's a gentleman following me a little bit later this morning who's going to talk a ton about the brain and the science of the brain, but you need to know one piece of it here to help understand the power of contrast. So I'm going to draw your brain right here. This is the big pink crinkly part. I told you it wouldn't be too scientific. And this is the other part. Daniel Kahneman calls it system one, which is the thinking fast part, and system two, which is the thinking slow part of his book, Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow. And what's interesting about the decision-making process is that in system one, the fast part of the brain is the emotional, intuitive part of the brain. And its job is to make the decision for change. The decision for change, as they've been able to identify using magnetic resonance imaging, takes place in this part of the brain, often referred to as system one, or the amygdala and limbic system. This part of the brain right here, This is an analytical part of the brain. So its job is to analyze, and its main job is to justify the decision to change. Interestingly, this is the part of the brain that contains the capacity for language. This part of the brain emotionally and intuitively decides to change. This part analytically justifies and validates that change. But here's where language is. This one's free for you today. When you ask a customer, what's it going to take for you to change? You do a focus group or a study. What's it really going to take for you to change? What part of the brain is the customer going to answer from? This part. But that is not the part that actually makes the decision to change, that releases a human from their status quo bias. This is the part that explains that in a way that people will accept. But the real reason you change is comes from a part of the brain where there's no capacity to explain that. So often we are led astray by research with customers who tell us this is what it's going to take to change, and what they're really saying is, I'm going to need this to validate that with my spouse. Or I'm going to need this to explain it to my friends. But the reality is something else happens here. And the thing that this part of the brain craves more than anything, because it doesn't have the capacity for language, is it craves contrast. This part of the brain primarily uses contrast to decide, because it is the stay or go, fight or flight part of the brain. And what it craves to make a decision is there enough contrast? Why? Because that's risky to do. I'm only going to take that leap if there's enough contrast and enough reason to do it. I mean, if there's not enough contrast between the two, why would I take the risk of change? So you need contrast in your story so people see that is worth the effort. So the emotional part of the brain contains and craves contrast. And the thing about contrast is it's also inherently visual. Because if you don't contain the capacity for language and you crave contrast, your story needs to be visual. That in truth, when you tell the story between current state and future state, when you tell any of the stories I've told you today, I have used visual contrast to show you the way people are doing it today versus the way it should be done, to show the limitations of the current state, red box, the better way, green box. The power of contrast is what's helping and aiding everybody make their decisions. And like I said, absent any contrast, the brain goes for contrast. It tries to find contrast, and that's when you get into a price battle. The battle of price is, if everything looks the same and it's all priced the same, I can't make a decision. But if somebody would lower their price, now I can make a decision. Why? Because it's cheaper? Not necessarily. Why? Because I have some contrast that helps me make that decision. So your job is to create enough contrast between what they're doing today and what they're doing tomorrow. And the research on that was pretty powerful too. We did some simulations. In this case, we put people in a simulation who had a smartphone less than a year, and we told them about a new professional grade smartphone. And some people listened to a presentation that just talked about the new and improved features and benefits. Other people heard a presentation that started with the limitations of one-year-old smartphones, the risks, the hacking risks, the data overload risks, the screen resolution risks. Your current phone is not a professional grade phone. Now let's talk about the new features of the professional grade phone. So some of the audience heard the story in contrast. Some heard the story just as a new and improved and were asked to infer whether or not this was a better phone. And we took people in a simulation right up to the point of purchase intent. We literally had them believing there was a phone they could buy. And what we were able to move the needle on was three things: 13% increase in their perception of whether or not the new solution was innovative. People in the contrast condition we saw a 13% increase in their ratings of how innovative or unique the new phone was. People without contrast who heard just the new and improved had a significantly lower perception of whether or not it was innovative, because we were forcing them to figure out the contrast as opposed to giving them the contrast. We saw a 14%+ increase in attitudes and choice. The idea being, if they had the chance, would they choose this phone over their current phone if they had the choice? And you could bump that up by people who saw it in the contrast condition versus the non-contrast condition. This was the big one. Then we asked them, purchase intention? Would they go to the next screen and order the phone? We generated a 15% higher purchase intention among the group that saw and heard the story in contrast versus those who just heard about the new and improved features and benefits. It is a small change to your message and story that can make it more powerful. Telling a story with contrast that helps people identify and self-persuade and try on what they're doing today and how different that is from what you're proposing so that they can see and understand the contrast and understand and know if there's enough value to make that decision. The power of contrast. So I've given you a number of ideas here this morning to deal with, to create a why change story, to get people off of status quo bias, to break the bondage of no decision. And if you're going to generate more leads, but not just more leads, but leads that are more likely to convert, you will have to have had dislodged the status quo bias. You will have had to do a better job of creating insights that actually incite someone to change, not just get a bunch of likes, a lot of viral passage, and a lot of excitement. And you have to whip a little science on this and tell a story. So the framework looks something like this. Introduce an unconsidered need to destabilize their current preferences, because the power of persuasion starts with uncertainty. If I'm certain, therefore I am not persuadable. You must introduce some uncertainty. You must show them through this idea of loss aversion that there's loss associated and costs associated with staying the same, not just some gain to be attained if they make the decision to change. You must show clear current state, future state contrast. Here's what you're most likely doing today, and here's what it can look like tomorrow to help people overcome the selection difficulty associated with making a decision. That's a really important one, self-persuasion and the power of contrast. And then finally, you can tell your proof story, a before and after story. Make it personal. The idea here is that we, in our books that we've written, have identified all the different ways of storytelling, and one of the most powerful forms of storytelling frameworks was accomplished by Alcoholics Anonymous. In Alcoholics Anonymous, they identified that you can't tell someone they're an alcoholic and have them take the course. They have to persuade themselves, but they only persuade themselves when they hear a story of someone like them. And that story can't be just, hey, here's how great my life is on the other side. That story must start with where I started, what it looked like, what it sounded like, what it felt like, what it smelled like, what I dealt with. So when you tell a customer success story, don't just talk about the upside on the other end. Talk about where the customer started and what it looked like in their organization and what they were dealing with. Why? Because the person you're talking to can't identify yet with the other side until they commit themselves and persuade themselves that they're living in the current state. So great success stories are before, after hero stories. What do I mean by hero story? Help the customer see the current state, self-identify, self-persuade, and then show them someone just like them who's made this journey, made this decision, and come out on the other side succeeding and well. I would argue that this is something that we do a pretty good job of, but I believe often two things are missing. One, it's misplaced. You lead with it too early before you've disrupted the preferences and you've shown the cost of staying the same and you've created enough contrast that I don't feel the urge. I mean, that's a really great success story, but I really haven't had my status quo disrupted enough yet to care. So you put it in too early. But the second thing is you often talk about the after without enough before so that they can really self-identify, self-persuade. So I call it the before and after hero story with contrast is the ideal story. And there's your framework. The destabilizing of preference stabilities with an unconsidered need, the loss aversion by showing them the cost of staying the same, as well as the gain that they can get. Clear contrast between the current state, give them a straw man to say that looks a lot like me, and then show them the difference in the contrast with the better way, resolve that risk, and then tell them a before and after story they can identify with. A simple four-part framework to defeat your main rival, the status quo, indecision. an opportunity to change the game by changing a few things subtly in your message and story. The reason this is so important is because you now have a choice. You can be either Gladwell or Grodzins. Hopefully now I've given you a tool, a simple framework, so that you can go out there and tell the better story, because the best story told the best will win. Thank you very much. I just want to point out this slide real quick. There's a link to a special ebook that I've created for you. It talks about the difference between decision science and best practices. None of what we do is based on observed best practices, because those can differ by culture and they can differ by era. But decision science and the science of the brain and the way the brain shapes value and the way the brain makes choices is universally, globally true, and has pretty much withstood the test of time. So it's an ebook on the difference between best practices and decision sciences in the art of marketing and selling. And I would encourage you to go get that. And we will also send you the slides so the visuals are completely legible. So thank you again.